Before starting, I wanted to actually thank Jaideep and Simran for making this session going to look like a part A and part B. They already spoke about Russia-Ukraine war and what all things has happened around it. But what is the intent, how generally cyber warfare happens? We start using the words so easily, the information warfare, cyber attacks, everywhere, wherever we want to. It's been put into many spots. But to be very precise, it's not something which is new. It's been with us human beings over years. So the one thought which I want to put in, like we always talk about war and we all evolved from war. So we are the one who survived so far war. How do you want to go ahead with a war? How do you win a war without even firing a single bullet? This is a thought which I want to let sink in your minds. Around 3,000, close to 2,500, 3,000 years back, Sun Tzu said, the more the army knows about itself and its enemy, the stronger it will be in the battle. Is it only about the battle? Is it only about in the conflicts? It could be even a CTF game. It could be even in your regular corporate affairs where you see your companies being targeted. It is between a defender and an attacker. In today's world, the concept of information warfare has evolved over centuries. Military strategies had recognized the importance of information as a war-winning factor long ago. Today, I would like to take you further and familiarize you all with the concept of information superiority. What is it and what all are involved? I am Lieutenant Commander Antony, a retired naval officer. I've been in information security field for around 15 years. Out of that, a decade went in defending country's defense as part of the Navy. Post that, I worked with PwC, GE, and currently I'm with National Australia Bank. I would like to make a special mention to my mentor, my boss, my previous boss, Commodore MP Anil Kumar. Sir is in the crowd, I believe. He's been the one who has forced us to, in our unit, has forced us to coin the term, which is information superiority, was used highly by US military. So in India, how do we use that in the percentage of network-centric warfare? I am just a child who is just delivering his baby, just passing across the message. What are we going to discuss about in this session? It's mostly like I'm going to talk you through about what is information warfare, what all elements are part of information warfare, and what is network-centric battlefield. The today's battlefield, what we are seeing, it's not going to be how you're seeing in the movies most of the time. It's a little different, how it is and what is there. And also, what all kind of possible and imminent targets are there, how people are using those targets, and how it can affect a civilian also. So we'll be talking about that. A quick heads up. There'll be a lot of things which are going to be basics just to clear out, because many are there from multiple agencies. There are people from police, people from IT, and people also from government agencies are here. So I'd be talking, making it more easy to understand for each of you. And particularly, this is only attributable to me. This is my perspective, and it's nothing to do about the perspective of how things work in Indian Navy or my previous employers or my current. So imperfect knowledge of a situation will bring the army to a standstill. What does this mean? Like, we hear about military actions, invaders. Have you ever seen any invader have been welcomed by common people? This is a picture of Napoleon Bonaparte when was completing his siege on Italy and was entering into Milan. Like, the people of Italy was welcoming him. This is something weird, right? So you won't welcome an external invader coming and then you wave him and then welcome. How did Napoleon achieve this? He was a great military strategist, but also he had a good propaganda. There is a team around him who has worked around altogether how to make Napoleon a hero. When you talk about Napoleon, the one picture what you might be remembering is this one, a heroic act. He's on a horse charging across. This is a painting of Napoleon crossing Alps mountain, right? But do you think this is practically true? Post-winter, when you cross Alps, it's going to be thickly covered by snow. You might be on a mule, sitting and covered with thick blankets, going and calmly just focusing on the siege which he's going to have on the target. But This is not what the propagandists were showing. Napoleon and his propagandists crafted a heroic image of him. Why? They cultivated the thought through literature, art, and everywhere, not only to motivate their troop, but also change the way how the adversaries started thinking. Right? So this made him be a hero not only in his country, but also in the adversarial nations, which is, in this case, Italy. In a nutshell, history is replete with examples of how information and information dominance have decisively changed the battles. Today, information warfare is not only these four, but also includes command and control warfare, which we call C2W, intelligence warfare, electronic, and cyber warfare. Since for the benefit of understanding of all, so we all being from the cyber ground, so I'm not going into each of the topics of C2W or PsyOps or electronic warfare, because they are themselves a bigger subject altogether. We would focus more on cyber warfare. So cyber attack and cyber warfare are used very commonly between everywhere. But what is cyber warfare? It refers to the digital tactics and techniques used by nation states or organizations which are supported by them. It is politically motivated and backed by them. So like in the last session, Jaideep and all were talking about hacktivists going around during the Ukraine-Russia war. And we call that war also as warfare. But it's all, the words are mixed up. We have to be very clear, what is a cyber attack? What is a cyber war? What is a large-scale information warfare altogether? By means, cyber has today evolved into the fifth dimension of warfare. What are the other dimensions of war or warfare? There are land, sea, air, and space warfare. So these are the four. Now you might be thinking, okay, post-corona, we all started talking about bio-warfare and all. It's not a separate warfare methodology. It is part of your either land warfare or air warfare. But cyber, by its own mean, it has become separate. How is it separate? It is completely different because in warfare, we have clear political boundaries. Whereas in cyber warfare, there is no clear-cut geopolitical boundary. This facilitates the conduct of cyber operations right across the border so easily. Wherever, like you are in India, you want to carry out a strike right opposite of yourself on the globe, it is so easy and possible, and it does not need a lot of mobilization of your troops. It allows high rate of operational maneuver. What is that? If you want to carry out a strike in a regular warfare, there is a lot of visibility. People start understanding something we call as cloud of war. There is, if you remember in the newspapers, you would have started seeing Indochina standoff period. The people of both nations started understanding, even world nations started understanding, there is a conflict going on between two nations. But whereas for cyber warfare, it is not necessary. It is just a click of a button. It is less than a fraction of seconds, right? And cyber warfare is cost effective. And what do we mean by high teeth to tail ratio? Now, to design an ICBM, intercontinental ballistic missile, or any kind of surface to surface missile, it takes around 30-40 crores. And can you achieve your intent finally very easy? No. If you want to, during a war, if you want to exactly hit a pinpointed location, for one hit, you might be doing multiple practice missile firings. So that involves cost. So roughly for one successful attack, you would have invested around 300 to 400 crores. I'm just taking a simple sample number. Whereas in a cyber war, you might be just going across the room and can see red team villages, how people are performing, right? They are getting all the exploits free of cost, which is there. It's all about the time and effort what a person do or your army or troops do to develop a cyber war. Even though if you procure a cyber weapon from outside, which is not going to cost equivalent to an intercontinental ballistic missile, but the impact it creates is going to be almost same. I think the previous speaker from Cyber was, I think Kumar Red was talking about the kinetic impact what the today's cyber war is creating, right? So let's, what I'm talking about kinetic impact. You are aware of aircrafts which are being flown by purely through GPS. Now, if I want to destroy this building, all I need to do, I'm just taking as for example, touch wood, it's not happened. So if I need to crash this building, I don't need to get RDX from outside. All I need to do is understand how to crash an aircraft in this pinpointed location. If that happens, it's a catastrophic destruction. For that, there is no missile being launched, right? Then the most important thing, which is attributability and covertness. In the previous session, we were seeing about many hacktivists coming up openly and then publicizing, okay, I'm supporting Ukraine, I'm supporting Russia. But did Russia say that we are the one who carried out certain attacks? Or even in the past attacks, conflicts between Iran, UK, and US, Israel, no one ever comes up, no nation state comes up and they say, this is being done by me. Maybe multiple civilian hacktivists might be talking and then claiming that this attack is attributable to them. But for a nation state, they are still a peace-loving nation, but never entered into a war. Now, before going into the topic of information superiority, I would like you to understand what is an information triangle looks like, because this is the most important component of an information warfare, right? So you have data which is in raw form, lacks no meaning. It is, or maybe having a little meaning. So the transformation of this data into processed, contextualized information is what is very important in a military environment or even in your corporate environment. So you have bits and pieces of data. When you process them, you get information. That information might look like, let's say, flight manifest. But the data in a flight manifest is just names, people's age, from which country they are coming from, all the stuff. So when you process multiple information, what you gain is the knowledge, which is at the decision maker's level. Example is, which unit has what kind of aircrafts, what is their flight manifest, when are they flying, what kind of rules of engagement they have, what kind of communications channels they are having. So now if you understand, the top of this notch is the wisdom. When you have multiple knowledge about your own force, what you inadvertently gain is the wisdom about the battle. Before you're going for a battle with someone, you now know what is going to be the possible outcome. It's like a chess game, how you play, right? Now, what is information superiority? Information superiority in the context of a battle space is the ability to process, disseminate an uninterrupted flow of information while exploiting and denying an adversary's ability to do the same. It's too much to digest. Simply put together, there is a defensive information superiority operation and there is offensive information superiority operation. Let me put it into a context. The picture which is representing here, there is two force capabilities, which is red force and blue force. Name yourself whichever country you want to. Red is your adversary and blue force is yourself. Now, in handling information, all of you might be aware, what is the most important thing of handling information? There are three components to it: CIA, confidentiality, integrity, and availability. I'm drawing the same three stuff. So you have information which is relevant, accurate, and available to you at the time when you need. So with this, the volume what you draw is the information what the battle commander or else the country knows about themselves from the previous triangle you would have seen. So now, when you carry out offensive operations, what you do in the offensive operation, you start attacking on any component of the CIA and try to bring down the information volume of your opponent. So the opponent knows little about them. Now, by doing defensive operations, what are you doing? You are not letting them know about you. So in the end game, if you see the information volume of your force, which is the blue force, looks larger than your opponent's. What does that mean? That means if your enemy knows an information about themselves, you now know, have the knowledge about what is he going to react. So if he has a complete knowledge of the battle space, you are one step ahead, you know how he is going to react. That's the wisdom. This is the greatest advantage of having information superiority over your adversary. So how do you achieve it? Right? In today's day, the prominent target is not only military. We talk about, okay, information warfare or information superiority attacks happen between countries only during military. No, it starts from critical information infrastructures, then governments and military. In critical information infrastructures includes your corporate companies too. I said in the beginning that I'll talk about how a battle space looks like, right? So I put in all the battle informations into a picture. In this, you might be noticing there is a land element here, which is the tanks, the rocket launchers, you have your ground stations and all. Then, now this ground station, for them to carry out a strike, there's something called as their visible range. For a tank or a rocket launcher to land their bomb in a spot, they can only launch till the location where they see. That's what we call it as the horizon vision area, right? So now for them to enlarge their horizon, what do? They use other elements like air units. So which conducts surveillance and reconnaissance for the ground units, they pass this information. Let's imagine army does not get the information what the air force is seeing. There is the delay. Now, what I'm trying to tell is, now if you want to drop a missile exactly on this spot, you have a GPS coordinate you're trying to drop here, but it didn't fall here. How do you get to know this information? Because the rocket launcher unit is not situated very nearby. They cannot see what's happening. So for this, you have surveillance aircraft, which is real-time flying above the surface, and passes in this real-time information to the battle commander. So now, if this attack failed, all it takes is for them to quickly correct themselves and come back. Within minutes, they can fire up another set of missiles, right? And now another force is the naval force, which has a capability of moving across the globe from whichever place they want with heavy weapons, right? For them also, they have a limitation to their sensors. Let's assume a Navy's fire control radar have a range of around 200 miles. Beyond that, if they want to launch a weapon, they don't know the range. How do they use it? They again connect with the maritime reconnaissance aircrafts, get the information. What I am trying to tell here is, if you put the bits and pieces together, in the information age, the methodology of operations have changed. Earlier days, if you want to pass a message from the ground unit, that is from an army unit to an air force unit, it takes months, or maybe, sorry, it takes hours. It is not going to happen real time. Whereas with the present age, this is almost real time communication transformation is happening. But is it coming with full sophistication? No, it's a cutting edge sword, which has two sides to it. Since we have a deeper information dependency on the information systems, these information systems are highly targeted. When I say information systems, what all are they? I just want to introduce few information systems to you. So we call them integrated systems because each of the systems talk to each other. There's C4I2 SR systems. Then there are fire control systems on board the weapon platforms. Then there are combat management systems, which control the whole combat. When you see a missile is being fired, somebody is passing the order to fire the missile. So that is a combat management system. Then comes the most interesting, which is I said about early warning and air defense systems. And then the integrated battle management system, which is you have multiple battle going on. Let's say there is an attack happening on a northern sector. There's another attack which is happening on the southern sector, which is the southern part of the country. There's something which is happening on the east. Now you need to put everything into a single picture and understand how things are happening. For a military commander, he cannot just believe in, okay, we won in the north, so we will have success in the south. So integrated battle management system, collaborate everything put together, gives a clear picture to the battle commander for making a real-time, well-advised decision. It is not like on the go they are making a decision, right? Now, these many integrated systems are there. What are these systems? These systems are nothing but computers and some electrical equipment and machinery equipments which are connected together. And apart from that, there is one more very interesting element in this. For all these communications to happen, you need satellite. So which leads the way to the possible attacks. So I'm taking few attacks which are more prominently can happen and can change the course of the battle. One, attack on satellite communication systems, GPS hacking, supply chain attacks, attack on embedded systems, and social engineering, right? Many have spoke about supply chain attacks, so I'm not going to touch too much into it. Now, what is a satellite communication attack? Right. So now, for you to have continuous real-time information, you have a huge dependency over the satellite. That's why countries started developing their own satellites and started trusting that satellite communication. But the recent Ukraine-Russia conflict have introduced a superb concept of destroying your own satellites. There are two ways you can actually affect the satellite communications. One is through kinetic means, by destroying the satellite altogether by maybe launching a missile or crashing it with another satellite altogether. Or else the second methodology is a cyber. Now, as you are aware, like last year or 2-3 years back, India have shown the capability of building its own ASAT missiles. We have the capability among multiple countries. Let's take, for example, China has it, Russia, US. But in cyber, what have we done so far? There is no prominent attacks which has shown with cyber means how you can bring down a satellite. This was done during the Russia-Ukraine conflict, where Ukraine was dependent on satellite communication over a satellite which is called as CARSAT. Right? CARSAT systems and modems gone down just 1 hour before the attack of Russia. So in a battle, what is more important? The more important is the element of surprise. So let's imagine you and your adversary both are standing front. Who is going to have the first punch on the other's face is going to be the most interesting part, right? That person has already a natural advantage. So this gave Russia a natural advantage. I'm not going too detailed into the satellite communication hack, what happened. It was clearly explained by their CISO during the last DEFCON, I believe. Feel free to go. You can see that DEFCON video about how that hack has happened, right? Then GPS hacking. Now, can you all raise who has not used your GPS to come to this venue? I'm sure those 2-3 hands which came, you are from Kerala, or most probably you might be from Cochin. Rest of us are highly dependent on, even coming to a simple location like Grand Hyatt, we are highly dependent on GPS. Let's imagine those who don't know Malayalam, those who don't know the land's geography, your location to come to Grand Hyatt, I'll take for example, sir, with your permission, our NCCC chairman, if our NCSC Google location is not bringing him to Grand Hyatt and redirect him to a different location which is 20 kilometers far, what would have been the impact in this event? This is very small, right? Morning, we are all waiting. The chief guest is not yet arrived because his GPS location is somewhere else. This is a very small cyber attack which can happen. But in real time, since 2014, there are many instances which has happened. A lot of countries did not talk about it. Many said, okay, this is not a cyber attack. This is just a glitch. But I'll take in places where it really happened. In Russia in 2014, people started noticing Kremlin's GPS location was not coming up in the phone. People whoever wanted to go to Kremlin, when they put their location, it was showing to Vnukovo Airport, which was, I think, farly around 20-25 miles off from Kremlin. Okay, that is in the land. What about in sea? So in Black Sea, close to 2018, around the vessels which were there in a specific location, if you see, those vessels, wherever the GPS was showing, we call it as AIS, Automatic Identification System. The system was showing the GPS location completely off track. It is not in the place where the ships are actually. But luckily they found it. How? In the ships, they carry, one is the GPS systems is there, and electronic charts are there. Apart from that, some people are still old style. They have their own charts and maps where they continuously plot. Few ships have noticed that we are completely off track. We are in a different position. So you might be thinking, what's the big deal? Okay, some fuel got lost, so they are in different place now. Let's change our location and then go to another place. At sea, let me tell you, it is not like when you are driving a car, you see an opponent, you immediately change the course of the car. You escape a incident, you don't crash. But whereas at sea, it is not like that. At pitch dark night, if a ship is proceeding in a route, believing purely on GPS location, and then another ship which is on the other side, if they are also coming, this is called as a collision. Two ships can collide if this GPS location is not properly showing. Otherwise, also I can make the ship run on the land. Can it run? It cannot. So that's kind, those kind of criticalities come in when we talk about the GPS issues in the sea. There were incidences where a couple of US Navy ships have collided each other. The world media started talking about this as a GPS hack incident, but US didn't take the ownership and they said it is not, it's a glitch. Recently, some of you would have heard, in the newspaper it came, 1st of October, around 15-20 aircrafts which are flying over Iran has got their GPS location differently mapped and they were entering into Iraq's airspace. Then Baghdad ATC has told the aircrafts, you are entering in a wrong space, let me re-guide you to Iran. So this really happened in recent, right? Even some of the Indian aircrafts have reported and they mentioned this and it came in newspaper. Now, this is all glitches. Now, what will happen in the real time, what can happen in a real time warfare? We know about Wing Commander Abhinandan's aircraft landed in Pakistan during our Balakot strike conflict, right? Now, let's imagine during a regular day sortie, an aircraft which is supposed to land in Indian space, but because of GPS malfunction, it landed in an adversary's air arena, or else maybe in their location. What would be the situation? It can start a war, or it can change the course of how your battle happens, right? During war, if you can't believe in the systems which is giving you clear-cut navigation, that's a huge risk. Is it only by navigation for vehicles? No. Today's most of the missile systems completely depended on GPS navigation. So there is a high chance of this can happen, right? Next, supply chain attack. As I said earlier, I think many speakers have covered about supply chain attacks. In the event of military, what is so prominent about supply chain attack is, today India have the capability of building its own equipments. Whereas sometime back, we were highly dependent on foreign OEMs, original equipment manufacturers. Your radars, your fire control systems are manufactured by outsiders. If they have an inherent malware, right, forget about that part. Most interestingly, if you want to procure a military equipment, it is possible today. You can procure and can do reverse engineering of it. A classic example to that is I'm just going a little ahead to tell, in Stuxnet or in IronGate, right, what happened is the equipments what they use in the critical infrastructure is commercially off-the-shelf available. So if a nation state actor wants to create a huge impact on a nation, all they need to do is buy it, do a reverse engineering, identify existing vulnerabilities in the equipment, or else plant a vulnerability and execute it or exploit it at the time of need. This has been in the prominent news since the Stuxnet attack. Right? All the CIIs, the critical information infrastructure, have this huge risk of attack on embedded systems. I want to bring out to notice about, there are two instances which happen in India where the organization said it is not a cyber attack. Even I'm not going to get into the discussion about whether it was a cyber attack or not. One is the Mumbai power surge. Next is during, there was a cyber incident in Kudangulam power, the nuclear power plant. We are not going to talk about whether it is a cyber attack or whether it was done by China during Indo-China standoff or not. But there is a huge possibility. Imagine the power which went off in Mumbai power grid. If it would have been a nation-state actor's activity and the power didn't come back for next 10 days or maybe for a month, right? What would be the impact? The impact forces you to make certain imminent actions, which is going to change the course of actions of the military leaders during a warfare. I want to touch upon a little bit on social engineering here. How much ever you make your system strong, the trained personnel form the crucial and integral part of your organizations, right? These are the weakest links mostly in the system also. I'm not blaming ourselves, but I'm just saying the human weaknesses what we have. You keep seeing most of the attacks. I can name a few, the Associated Press, Twitter hijack, even US DOD was compromised with simple social engineering attacks. You don't need to have it in a very clandestine or sophisticated way. There are sophisticated methods which are going on, but you keep seeing government agents and military officers and police staff, many are being trapped in social engineering attacks. Is it only with government? Is it not happening with tech firms? No, it's not. On the left side, you might be seeing GitHub have clearly warned North Korean hackers were targeting Indian tech firms and Indian tech firm leadership, particularly the architects who were involved. Because we don't get a holistic picture of a simple information leakage, how it can affect their company, but not only the company, but also the country's information security posture. I think I made enough efforts to scare you all. Now, is it all going to be so dangerous? Am I selling here a product? No, not at all. No offense to everyone. But there are many good, better, best actions we can take. But I want to call out only two here, right? So I really love Cocoon for one reason. This is one place where you start seeing our own policemen start looking at us and all the time smiling. I don't know whether it's the charm of Kerala or is it the charm of how the senior police leaders ensure this event happens. We start seeing police as friends. The same way we should start seeing the national organizations like NCCC, NTRO, NCIIPC as our friends and start sharing the information about attacks or weaknesses in your organizations. This does not happen between two organizations. I still remember when I was in PwC, when the moment CERT came up with the advice of informing the cyber attack within 6 hours to CERT, many organizations, I'm not naming anybody, I'm just saying many organizations started feeling reluctant. Why should I do that? If I don't do, what will happen? Is there any legal form? Will they arrest me? Will they arrest me or my CISO? Or will they arrest my CIO? Who is responsible? So we try to evade because we don't see them as our friends who are supporting. At a conflict, you are now seeing what has happened, what you would have already seen what has happened in Ukraine, right? Let's assume it is happening in India. Your whole nation is going to be bring down to bottom. It's not about only the profit of your company or it's not about your company's image. It's about survival. During a battle, things can go any side, any ways, which is like we call it can go any sideways, right? So if you want to prevent it, start building that rapport. And there's a request also, mostly these bigger organizations, they also become friendly. They are advising, they are mentoring CISOs. So we need to be not in silos, but also coordinate very well, right? Another one I want to call out, which I noticed, I was talking to a couple of leaders who are entrepreneurs who are developing tools. There is no specific testing tool. We don't have many places. Let's take, for example, in cryptocurrency. There is no clear-cut testing methodology in blockchains, right? We generally follow NIST or CASF, or CAS or ISO 27001. For every nation, there should be testing capability clearly defined. We should be having frameworks. So that you trust that framework, you go ahead with it, and national organizations start guiding people for testing, because otherwise the inherent issues like embedded system security or supply chain attacks are going to be there with us as far as we keep talking. We need good testing standards. With that, I'm coming to the conclusion. So all these things, what I said about information superiority and all those things started from 1990s in US by US military. But how does it really happen? If you think Russia-Ukraine war is a classic example of cyber warfare, no, it is not. The classic example is during 2021, there was a conflict between Israel, in fact, US and Iran on Natanz nuclear facility. What is the option for a country? Either you can send your military and create catastrophic problems or carry out a military strike. So you're going to shell out a lot of money, there will be loss of life, there will be destruction, there will be more issues with terms of your nation's viewpoint. Like if you are a peace-loving country like India, you cannot just straight away go into war because of a small conflict. But what did they choose? They choose cyber warfare, right? When they took cyber warfare, they did it everything remotely. Today also, now I am assuming it could be Russia, sorry, it could be US or Israel, but there is no attributability. The Natanz facility was brought down. This problem is solved. Nobody died, no blood spill, not even a single bullet being fired. This is what is information superiority. This is being even told by Indian strategists for a long time back. That is, our own Chanakya said, enemy should not know your weakness, but you should know enemy's weakness. That is information superiority. Hope it made sense. Jai Hind, you've been a lovely audience. Thank you so much.